is a little different. Well, first of all, hey, how are you? I hope that you're doing well, and I'm so happy to have you here. Second, let's talk about Fatal Frame. So I'm not sure if it was apparent in any way. It's not like I've ever brought it up or anything, but there's a certain video game franchise that I have a very healthy love for. That, you know, I've definitely never been weird about, definitely not used it as excuses to have fun at school projects or anything, you know, like graded assignments or what have you. I didn't have my speech class be held captive while I gave an informational breakdown of all of Fatal Frame 2. Anyhoozle, did you know that there's a live-action movie adaptation of Fatal Frame? Because there is. So I thought, why not take an opportunity to look at it compared to the game franchise and do the first video in a new series I would like to try out of video game to live-action movie adaptations. I figure since I absolutely adore video games and come from the movie biz, why not do a critical analysis of these adaptations? I think it could be really fun and also just like a fun learning experience for me. I've never really done video essays, and even though my degree is literally in writing, didn't actually write a lot of essays in my life. So this is gonna kind of be a new experience for both of us. Before we jump into this, I want to give a serious content warning. I absolutely love this franchise. It is very near and dear to my heart. It's not happy, to put it mildly. There are a lot of incredibly potentially upsetting things in this franchise. Everything from murder to like self-murder and like torture murder and like sibling murder. There's a lot of death. Like a lot. Like a lot. I also want to include a spoiler warning. While I'm gonna try not to spoil too much about the video games themselves, I will be spoiling the entirety of the movie. I will give an additional warning before we get to the end part analysis, but if you really want to go in like blind on that movie, I would recommend just, you know, come back to this video after, go watch the film for yourself, then come back here and then we can chat. Let's go. In a world where people are always singing the praises of Silent Hill and Resident Evil, I feel as though one franchise is continuously overlooked and underappreciated. A horror franchise spanning 5 major games, spin-offs, a remake, manga adaptations, a novel, and the best format of all, pachinko machines. Oh right, and a movie. Yes, this rather vast franchise has a lot to offer and is one I happen to hold near and dear to my heart. The eerie, ghost-filled scream machine that is, of course, Fatal Frame. Scene. That's seriously one of my favorite scenes in video game history. I don't know what that says about me, but God, I love that scene. It's so good. Fatal Frame, otherwise known as Zero or Project Zero, has always been and will always be one of my favorite video game franchises. A series of fairly standalone entries set in and around the 80s, always featuring a dark and twisted plot, centering around some forgotten Japanese village that sacrificed girls to appease an ancient god.
Technically, yes, there
have been sacrifices made with male victims, specifically thinking about in Fatal Frame 2, where the sacrifices were just twins, gender didn't really matter. So, yes, there have been some male sacrifices, but usually it is girls. Like, the vast majority of the time, it is girls. Of course, the ritual always goes awry and somehow traps a new set of victims who have to figure out how to escape before it's too late. It's not exactly an unheard of plot, but Fatal Frame's execution of it, combined with its memorable gameplay, always promises a good time. What are the game mechanics? Horrifying! And by that I mean genius. Throughout the Fatal Frame games, ghosts will try to kill you for whatever ghost reasons they have. That's what you get for going into that creepy village in the woods where people keep disappearing. So how does one fight a ghost? By taking their photo. Fatal Frame draws on the myth that cameras steal souls, though with an added layer. Simply snapping a shot won't do much. No, you have to wait. Until they lunge. Only when they're a hair's breadth away can you try and capture that elusive Fatal Frame, the most damaging attack in the game, and sometimes the only one that will do any damage. Having to wait until an enemy is close to fight them? That's intense. With this kind of gameplay and story, it sounds like an easy horror movie adaptation to make, right? Super straightforward, yeah? Well, not exactly. Zero, the movie, is a good film. The script, the acting, the visuals, it's all good. The plot doesn't follow any of the games, though. It's actually from a novel based on the video game franchise, but it has the same essence of the series. A group of young girls caught up in a secret ritual that curses them, and now they're slowly being picked off one by one? Yeah, that sounds like Fatal Frame, especially since the ritual revolves around a photo. But the first clue that this movie and the novel that inspired it is a bit different is the type of ritual. Usually, the catalyst is some sort of torture and murder of young girls in the name of a bloodthirsty god, but here, it's different. The ritual is simple. Kiss a photo of the person you like at midnight. The only problem is that everyone who does this little game disappears. At least, until they're found dead later, apparently having drowned in a nearby river. But why? What about kissing this photo curses these girls? That's exactly what the remaining characters intend to find out. The film centers around Aya, the most popular student at an all-girls Catholic school.
Yeah, so remember when I said that they kissed the photo of their crush? Yeah, their crush? These girls? And the person? That they like? You know? Did you catch that? Did you catch it? Yeah?
That's right. This film went with a sapphic love route. A surprising choice considering Japan's conservative views. So some students choose to kiss Aya's photo, unable to resist its charm, even after their friends start to disappear. Seemingly in response, Aya shuts herself away in her room, refusing to come out. Michi, a girl who had witnessed her friend do the ritual earlier, goes to perform it herself when Aya emerges from hiding and stops her. Aya explains that the photo is not actually of her, but a doppelganger. Intrigued and afraid, the two girls team up and start to investigate. Along the way, they meet Mary, a photographer. More photography references! But Mary has a peculiar sort of shrine in her studio. Photos of lesbians who made suicide pacts and drowned themselves in a lake due to the homophobia they experienced. It's sad, seeing all the photos of women whose love wasn't accepted by society, but it's also sweet that they're being remembered. Mary also tells the girls a story of one couple in particular, a pair who was doomed when one of them refused suicide, causing her to be haunted by her dead lover for the rest of her life. Upon hearing Mary's story, Aya confesses that when she was a child, she watched someone die and that she feels guilty for it. This theme of being haunted by one's past is in a lot of Fatal Frame games, which isn't too surprising considering how much death there always is.
Fatal Frame 3 in particular deals with the survivor's guilt when the lead character Ray's fiancé dies in a car accident and she starts seeing his ghost. Or Yuri from Fatal Frame 5, who was orphaned due to a car accident and because of this, now sees ghosts. Apparently, if you want to see ghosts, you just need to be in a horrible car accident that kills all your loved ones. The more you know. There's also Fatal Frame 1's star character, Miku, where the loss of her brother not only haunts her, but also led to some questionable plot choices.
We don't need to talk about the ghost marriage. That's a different video that I will not make. I don't want to give that more thought than I have. Moving on.
And Fatal Frame 2's whole story about twins where one twin is forced to kill the other. Lots of lingering loved ones there just casually reminding survivors of their death. No big deal. Back in the film, in a move that solidifies her as the movie's sacrificial heroine, Michi decides to perform the ritual in order to try and save Aya's soul. Sure, why not? Michi chains herself to Aya in this incredibly symbolic way because, as anyone knows, red is a powerful color, and strings like this represent a powerful bond. They are going all in on the symbolism in the shot. Of course, this rope does nothing, and they get separated. So now a new guy named Takashi, brother of one of the school's nuns, kidnaps Aya.
This is the moment. This is your warning. I am about to spoil the ending of the movie. If you do not want the ending spoiled, this is the time that you should jump to. Granted, this is going to jump to, like, me analyzing it, so, like, there could still be some spoilers, so tread carefully, okay?
Takashi throws Aya into the water where all the lesbian couples killed themselves years ago, which prompts Aya to remember that the person she watched die was her own twin. Her twin that is also the girl in the photo. Spirit photography and a dead twin, another tie-in with the games. Speaking of connections, Takashi's sister is named Mayumi Aso. Fans of the games will recognize Aso as the name of the camera obscura's inventor, along with the spirit radio. He is arguably also the reason any of the Fatal Frame games take place due to his actions throughout his life, but that's a different story. Anyway, back in the movie, our hero Michi is about to be drowned by Mayumi Aso. Yes, the nun is the person who's been killing all the girls in order to hide how her brother Takashi may have killed Aya's twin all those years ago. Nothing covers up one potential murder like a whole string of other murders. With the authorities closing in on them, Mayumi decides to drown herself along with her brother, and Michi meets back up with Aya. A happy ending. Well, except for everyone who died. But wait, remember photographer Mary? She decides to do a little digging of her own and figures out that the school's headmistress is actually the woman who didn't kill herself and is still being haunted by her dead lover. Apparently, to keep her ghostly girlfriend at bay, she's the one who killed Aya's twin, Maya, so that her lover would have some company. So Takashi actually hadn't killed anyone, and Mayumi didn't need to commit all those murders.
Guess that murder was a whoopsie. I guess my brother, like, didn't kill that girl, and I didn't need to kill all these other girls. It's a really weird choice of a cover-up. Oopsies.
Now, with everything tied up as best it can be, Michi tells Aya goodbye because she's going off to study photography in Tokyo. She goes to take a photo of Aya and sees the ghosts of all the victims surrounding her, but it's not scary. It's actually rather sweet. Them all smiling and posing together. Which is what makes it a bit annoying that Michi changes her mind and doesn't take the photo. Instead, Michi makes Aya promise to wait for her to come back as a proper photographer. Cool, but all the ghost girlies were posing for you! And you ignored them. Rude. Anyway, this somewhat sweet take on sapphic romance gets a bit tainted when she and Aya go in for a kiss, but Michi pulls back. The ending voiceover talks about how they've become adults, but will always remember when they were under that curse that affects girls. And that's what it is. The novel on which this movie is based is literally called A Curse Affecting Only Girls, and the curse is lesbianism. They're saying that loving another girl is a phase, that the curse she and the others suffered was just a homoromantic fling that they'll outgrow. Ouch? The entire story is based on death at the hands of homophobia, yet the movie's final words show Michi's another product of a harmful society. She's perpetuating the harm of which she herself was almost made a victim. None of the events that took place would have happened if people had simply accepted homosexuality instead of denying all these women their right to a happy life together. So, I think at face value, the ending of this movie can very easily be interpreted as homophobic. The ending monologue is literally, "And just like that, we became normal adults. Our time of being young girls is over, but we will never forget that time we were under a curse where only girls can be affected." So, the language here is very interesting. First of all, they said, "When we become normal adults," because any kind of queerness is seen as not normal, which, by the way, isn't true. So I potentially optimistically interpret the ending as being more a commentary on society and how there is this, you know, overwhelming heteronormative pressure, where it's like, oh no, you have to, like, fit this mold that we've already decided. So, oh, you have, like, these feelings and these thoughts and this attraction to someone. Well, like, that's not okay. So pretend that that doesn't exist. Like, hide that, shield that away, to become normal. So I kind of view it as, hey, maybe they're just saying, this is now who we have to be in order to be accepted. So this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna hide who we really are. And that is an incredibly, incredibly sad ending. But it's better than it being a really homophobic one. Also, another bit of language in this ending, which obviously the name of the novel on which this is based is A Curse Affecting Only Girls, is literally the title. I think the word choice of girls is also very interesting and ties into the fact that this is something that is somewhat accepted when you're a kid, but then when you go out into the world to be an adult or a normal adult, that stops. Like, that curse, you can't have that curse anymore. So I think that also, that's more language that ties into it. Some people love who they want to love. Life's hard enough as it is. You don't gotta make it harder. Why are you being like that? It doesn't affect you. Go home. Just go home. Go to bed. Viewers of the film may notice plenty of references and imagery related to Ophelia, the legendary Shakespearean character from one of his most famous works, Hamlet. Even in the film, the school's choir sings Ophelia's song. Ophelia is known for her perceived hysteria that ends in a tragic drowning. Her death is attributed as suicide by some characters, but others are quick to argue against that accusation due to the religious implications it would mean for her soul. Ophelia is a much adored character, a representation of the lack of bodily autonomy women often face and the control under which they suffer at the hands of men. In Hamlet, Ophelia barely appears, yet each time she does, it's to be told how to think and act by men in her life, and they overtly objectify her, stating that women only have value while they're young, pretty, and a virgin.
What is Ophelia here, sir, dear?
So please you. Something touching the Lord Hamlet.
May well be thought. It is told me he hath very often lately given private time to you. And you yourself have of your audience been most free and bounteous. If it be so, as so it is put on me in that way of caution, I must tell you, you do not understand yourself so clearly as it behoves my daughter and your honor. What is between you? Give me up the truth.
He has, my lord. of late, made many tenders of his affection to...
Affection? Pooh! You speak like a green girl unsifted in such perilous circumstances.
If a girl defies any of those requirements, she is no longer of use to the world. Ophelia accepts this role at first, yet when her father dies, she begins to go mad. She shows up singing sexual songs and passing out flowers, an act that several argue is a representation of deflowering herself, especially when she gives herself an herb that is a known abortive. So why am I saying all of this in a video about Fatal Frame? Well, as said earlier, the movie uses a lot of imagery inspired by Ophelia's iconic and watery death. More than that though, she is a representation of women whose blind following of society's expectations led to her death. She lived in a world where she was only seen as worthwhile if she acted the way others wanted her to, the way society demanded that she act. And when, through her grief, she wasn't able to fill that role anymore, she let herself die. When she fell into the water, she didn't struggle. She let the water seep into her skirts, let herself be weighed down and taken under. She decided that letting herself slip away into oblivion was a better fate than trying to live in a society that no longer wanted her. Ophelia may not have been a lesbian, though some people have wondered if she was. But her experiences are very much like those explored in this film and members of the queer community. Another connection between Ophelia, the movie, and the game series is water. Water is an important element in each of them, with Ophelia and the girls in the movie all having drowned, and with the main plot of Fatal Frame Maiden of Black Water. This game came out the same year as the novel and the movie, and it centers around a mountain that's known for two things: ghosts and suicides, both of which are connected to nearby bodies of water. It also features a whole bunch of ghost weddings, which ties in with Mary's shrine of couple photos. I can't speak on how much of the various studios were aware of one another's plots while in development, but it seems as though the general themes are the same in each. Even one of the game's antagonists is a man who was driven insane and kills a bunch of shrine maidens, i.e. young girls, before killing himself. Seems like a similar character type to Mayumi, the antagonist who kills girls before taking her own life. The central plot to Maiden of Blackwater is even about a ghost girl who fell in love before she was sent to complete a ritual, and that forbidden love caused the ritual to fail, thereby bringing destruction to the village. And the person she loved? Dr. Asso! Like I said, this dude unintentionally caused everything in the Fatal Frame series to happen. So while Maiden of Blackwater doesn't focus on sapphic love, it is about a forbidden love which led to water-related death. Though interestingly, there is a somewhat ambiguous relationship in the game in the form of Rui. Rui is my favorite character in the game. Like, look at them! Look at them! Adorable! Now the English translation of the game has Rui state, "I'm a girl," during a cutscene. But in the original Japanese, Rui only says, "I'm," before being cut off. Apparently, the game developers didn't agree on Rui's gender, with Matako Shibata saying he views Rui as trans. As for myself, I would like to give my support to the theory that Rui is both male and female. I mention Rui as a connection to the Zero film, not just because they happen to resemble Nietzsche a bit, but also because Rui has a romantic subplot. Since Rui's gender is never explicitly stated in the original game, it could be interpreted as a queer relationship, one that, depending on the player's actions, can have a happy ending. Forbidden love ruining rituals is actually a common catalyst in the Fatal Frame games. The first game had Kirie falling in love with an outsider before going to be sacrificed, which leads to the ritual failing. The third game's Reika saw her lover killed, and so her ritual failed. And we already covered what happened in the fifth game, Maiden of Blackwater. Funnily enough, games 1, 3, and 5 are the games that have the character Miku Hinasaki in them. That girl sure is cursed.
Oh, I shouldn't have done that yet. That was a mistake. Can I undo it. I take the photo back. I give it back. No. No.
Slides.
So let's review the elements that the movie has that are also in the games. We have ghosts, water, photos, young girls, forbidden love, rituals, and death. But there is still one thing missing. The iconic camera obscura. Sure, it's there, it's in the film, but it's never used, making it more of an Easter egg than a plot point. Now, removing the combat component when making it a movie isn't necessarily a bad idea. A big risk for video game to movie adaptations is to focus too much on gameplay elements. For example, if the actual gameplay is largely just fetch quests and puzzle solving, that can be really fun to play, but really boring to watch.
I love that I'm saying that as someone who definitely has live-streamed puzzle games and live-streamed all of these games. Self-own. Yeah.
Interactivity can greatly affect how much entertainment value a piece of media has. So, while ditching the camera obscura did make it feel less like the game, I didn't mind it so much. Instead, the element I felt Zero the Movie was missing was a more malevolent threat. Without any combat, there wasn't any need to have the same overwhelming scares of hordes of ghosts chasing the characters around or big horrifying entities trying to kill them. Because of this, it lacks the same tension you get when playing the games, even though it still pulls off some good spooky moments. Bad change, just one that kept it from being as scary as any of the games. This change away from fighting to survive did also keep Zero from becoming something closer to Ju-on or Ringu, so maybe it was a good change to make from an artistic standpoint. A way to stand out in a bit of an oversaturated market. Now for the real question. Does this movie work as an adaptation of the games? My verdict is yes. While it might not be as in-your-face scary as the video games, the atmosphere is still dark and suspenseful, and the plot is fairly in line with the franchise it represents. Choosing to adapt a novel instead of any of the entries in the game series was perhaps a safe choice, a way to try and honor the franchise without angering any of the fans by making any necessary changes during the adaptation process. Because yes, changes always have to be made when adapting any kind of work into another format if you want the new end product to be any good. As a standalone movie, it was fine. Nice acting, pretty visuals, interesting symbolism. As an adaptation of one of my favorite video game series, it wasn't bad, but I think I might have preferred if they had done one of the games instead of the novel. Again, I think it was a safe choice to go with the book, and it's not a bad story. But I'd like to see them do one of the stories from a game, something that is apparently in the works with Silent Hill film director Christoph Gans at the helm. Biased as I am, I would love to see him take on the Fatal Frame franchise. I would also love to see the third game adapted, seeing as it's my favorite, though I think the first or the third would both be good options to be made into films. I know, everyone loves Crimson Butterfly, but the whole convenience of it just keeps it from being my favorite. I mean, a village that sacrifices twins, and then a set of twins just happen to go there? No, I can't. Still a great game. I loved playing it. I just can't give it the same love as other people do. Don't get me wrong, though. I'd still watch a movie version of it. I just think that there are stronger entries in the series. But I guess if they are making more, it makes sense to just go in order since some of them connect to one another. Though, if they're going chronologically, I guess we'll be seeing Mask of the Lunar Eclipse. Considering this game only recently got a Western release, I would enjoy it getting the first direct adaptation since it's one most audiences know least. Though, with a large cast of characters and so many storylines to track, a cohesive film may pose a bit of a challenge to new audiences. Either way, I'm excited to see more.
So, that was a little dive into the Zero movie. What did you guys think? Have you seen the movie? Are you going to see the movie now? Or has this just completely turned you off from the franchise and you don't ever want to hear me talk about Fatal Frame ever again? I could do that. I have willpower. I'm kidding. I will literally never stop talking about this series. Never. If you've already seen the movie, what are your thoughts? Do you have different interpretations? Do you have anything to add? I would absolutely love to hear about this movie. I like doing this whole thing because it's been a minute since I've played a Fatal Frame game. So getting to do this video and like going back through and watching everything, I just got like so much more back into it. I love this franchise. It's so fun. Again, I feel like I should be concerned with how much I love such a dark and upsetting franchise. We're gonna ignore it. Also, yeah, did you know there are like 50 some live action adaptations of video games? Because I didn't when I said, I want to watch every single live action adaptation. There are things on that list that I've never even heard of the game. But I will watch them, and I will do an essay on it. Okay, I've gotten to the point where I'm just saying really stupid things, so let me know what you think, and hope you have a good day, and bye!
Shout out and thank you to all my patrons and Twitch subs. New merch is available. Use the links down below to grab yourself some swag, and more is in the works. Thank you all for watching. Bye!